Hello students, looking at current affairs for 5th May, these are actually the important keywords which will be coming up in today's news. So I have picked them up here. You can see first one is regarding migrant workers. We have already seen migrant workers are going to return on special trains. These are called Shramik special trains. But then the question now arises, who will bear the cost of this travel? So railway says it is the sending states. They say they can, you can procure it from the returning states based on receiving states based on your arrangement. Center says we are going to pay 85% of the cost now, and state would pay the remaining. So there is no clarity yet. Then here you have second one is stranded Indians abroad to return. So if in phased manner we are going to get Indians stranded abroad. Since the lockdown has been announced on March 22, they would be returning. Third is regarding special corona fee, which Delhi government has announced on alcohol. 70% special corona fee now, because of the huge crowds which was seen on at alcohol shops on the first day when alcohol shops were open. And this is regarding right to life, Article 21, and Swaraj Abhiyan 2 versus Union of India case 2016. So this is in the context of a PIL petition which has been filed in the Supreme Court by former Union Minister Jairam Ramesh. And this is UV blaster, which DRDO has developed. We'll see that as well. And regarding NAM, non-aligned movement, which had a video conference held presently. So here are the important headlines which have been picked up from the Hindu newspaper. So we'll look at each of these news items in detail. The first one, confusion prevails over who will foot migrants' train fare. So railways has said that sending states need to pay for sending people home on the Shramik specials, and it has also said that states may decide to bear the cost or take it from the passenger or even take it from the receiving state after mutual consultation, or may charge it to any fund. So it is your prerogative, but railways wants the payment from the sending states. Then Health Ministry as such has claimed that the government has started the Shramik specials on the request of states, but it will bear 85% of the cost and states will have to pay only the remaining 15%. So all this development happened after Congress President Sonia Gandhi asked the parties, Congress party state units, to bear the cost of rail travel of migrant workers, because central government had not taken the responsibility and railways was asking the sending states to pay. So she asked the states to bear the cost, Congress ruled states. So that resulted in central government pitching in and saying that we are going to bear 85% of the cost. So we'll see what happens actually on the ground. The next is not for return of stranded Indians. So government has decided to allow hundreds of thousands of Indians who have been stranded abroad in different parts of the world to return home in a phased manner now. So this will begin on May 7. You can see in the first phase, distressed citizens will be brought back on commercial aircraft and naval ships. And this will be strictly on a payment basis. So here also the question of payment arises. So these Indians stranded abroad, returnees would have to pay for coming back to and pay for the quarantine and hospital facilities that they'll need on returning to. So this is the condition being put by the central government. First phase of returning would be from May 7 to May 14. And 60 non-scheduled commercial flights will operate from about 12 countries to India. So at least half of these 60, that's around 30, would be coming from the Gulf region, UAE, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Kuwait and Oman. And rest would bring passengers from other countries like US, UK, Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines and Bangladesh. So this has been announced. The full estimate of Indians who want to return home could be around more than 10 lakh. 10 lakh is equal to 1 million. So they want to return home, and out of these 2 lakh, more than 2 lakh have registered to return from UAE, one country alone. So you can imagine the number of Indians stranded abroad who want to return since March 22, when the lockdown was announced and the government stopped commercial flights coming into the country. So here is the detail given to, you can see how they will be brought back in the phased manner, and the first phase starts from May 7 to 14. The next is, states with high swine flu rate record more COVID-19 cases. So five states, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Delhi and Tamil Nadu. These five states account for about 70% of India's confirmed COVID-19 cases. And these are also the same states who account for bulk of swine flu cases every year too. Seasonal influenza cases, H1N1, as every year since 2015. Like last year, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Delhi, and Maharashtra, four states together accounted for 54% of confirmed H1N1 cases in India. And a year earlier, in 2018, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Gujarat, and Rajasthan made up 65% of H1N1 cases. So this linkage has been highlighted. So here you can see how Maharashtra, Gujarat, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, and Rajasthan have a huge number of COVID-19 cases. And they also have the most H1N1 cases also in the last decade. The next is special corona fee on liquor in Delhi. So after a day of chaos at liquor shops, Delhi government has decided to charge 70% over and above the MRP of alcohol as special corona fee. So this will come into effect from today itself, from 5th May, and the Delhi Excise Act has been amended to provide for this. Next is Supreme Court to hear PIL on food security for all. So Supreme Court is set to hear a public interest litigation petition filed by Congress Rajya Sabha member Jairam Ramesh seeking universal coverage under the PDS and food security for all amid an acute food shortage due to the ongoing nationwide lockdown. So he highlights that how there are people who are suffering and are dying due to starvation. So to mitigate the food shortage and prevent deaths of the poor, government should relax this requirement of ration cards for supply of rations at PDS, no, public distribution shops. So during the COVID-19 pandemic, this step can be taken. It highlighted how there are many who are excluded because they don't have ration cards, and high courts and Supreme Court as such has actually in the past also suspended this requirement of ration card in cases of drought. So in situations of drought, like in the Swaraj Abhiyan versus Union of India case 2016, the Supreme Court had ruled that it would be inappropriate for state governments to deprive any household in drought affected areas of the requisite food grain merely because they do not have a ration card. So ration card could be substituted by any other valid identity card or proof of residence. So this was the ruling of the Supreme Court in 2016 in drought situation. So similar ruling from the Supreme Court has been demanded in this petition during this COVID-19 pandemic by Congress MP Jairam Ramesh in this PIL. So it is highlighted that how right to food is part of right to life under Article 21 of the Constitution. So right to food, water, decent environment, education, medical care, shelter, all are intrinsic to a good life and a part of right to life as Supreme Court has interpreted over the years. So right to life under Article 21 is interpreted in this wider context. So here you can see how right to life has been the definition has been expanded in various cases over the years. Like freedom from starvation is important as important as right to life. This was Keshav Nanda Bharti case in which Supreme Court had ruled so. Right to life would take within its sweep the right to food. So this was also a Supreme Court ruling in a case. In Kharak case also we have seen it's not right to life just for humans, but right to not restricted to mere animal or physical existence, but it should be with human dignity. So, you know, necessary for life is also adequate nutrition, clothing, as well as shelter. So, this is there. The next is DRDO develops a disinfection tower. So, Defense Research and Development Organization has developed an UV disinfection tower named UV Blaster. It's an ultraviolet disinfection tower for rapid and chemical-free disinfection of high infection-prone areas. So it can be used for electronic equipments, computers and other gadgets in laboratories and offices which are not suitable for disinfection with chemical methods. So it is also effective for areas where there are huge flow of people like airports, shopping malls, factories, etc. So it can disinfect a 12 by 12 feet dimension within 10 minutes. So this is the UV disinfection blaster which has been developed by DRDO. The next is PM slams Pakistan in virtual NAM meeting. So non-aligned movement, NAM, had its virtual meet which took place, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi made an indirect reference to Pakistan during this online meeting. And he said some countries were fomenting terrorism in the midst of global pandemic. NAM meeting actually was on the theme United Against COVID-19. So Mr. Modi in this context has also urged World Health Organization to focus on building health capacity in developing countries. So basically, we should know about NAM, non-aligned movement. It was founded in 1961 in Belgrade And the founding fathers were five prominent leaders: India's first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, Indonesia's first President Sukarno, Egypt's second President Nasser, Ghana's first President, and Yugoslavia President Joseph Tito. So these were the founding fathers, as such. So on the invitation of Joseph Tito of Yugoslavia, members of Bandung Conference were invited to Belgrade in Yugoslavia, in Europe, in 1961 for a summit, and this was where non-aligned movement was officially established. So these were five leaders of developing countries, and they wanted a middle course, and this was a period of the Cold War. Means there were two blocks, Western blocks and Eastern bloc, headed by USA and Soviet Union respectively, and countries did not want to align with either of the two. So that is the non-aligned movement. A middle course was sought by these newly independent developing countries, and this was the initiation of non-aligned movement. There have been statements which have come that non-aligned movement is no longer relevant because we don't have a bipolar world anymore. It's a unipolar world with US as the sole superpower now. But then still, the relevance of NAM cannot be degraded, and it is still relevant because, again, aligning with any power, any pole, is not correct. So you have to be just on the middle course. You cannot shift towards any camp, any grouping. So this is regarding Panchsheel too. That was in 1954 between India and China, the Panchsheel agreement. But then this also formed the basic principles under NAM, non-aligned movement. So these five principles under Panchsheel were mutual non-interference in each other's internal affairs, mutual non-aggression, equality for mutual benefit, respect for each other's territorial integrity and sovereignty, and peaceful coexistence. So these are basis for NAM as well. And objectives of NAM, like, they were to eliminate all causes which would lead to war. So we had the First World War, Second World War, and then came the period of Cold War, and there was fear that any conflict could result in a Third World War. So that period was a period when steps were needed to be taken to contain the crisis and not result in a Third World War. So objectives of NAM was also to eliminate all causes which could lead to war, protect nascent freedom of newborn independent countries of Asia and Africa from colonial domination, oppose colonialism, imperialism, and racial discrimination, encourage friendly relations among countries, advocate peaceful settlement of international disputes, oppose use of force and use of nuclear weapons. We had seen the Second World War ended with Hiroshima and Nagasaki being bombarded by atom bombs in Japan by USA. To strengthen United Nations as an organ of world peace, and to protect human rights, protect environment, and build a new International Economic Order, NEIO, should be based on equality, equity, and justice, not preferring some countries, developed countries, over developing countries. So new International Economic Order was also proposed to be built. So that was new. And the last news is China province launches anti-racism push after outrage. So this is China's southern Guangdong province that has launched a raft of anti-discrimination policies targeting businesses and venues as such. So actually, the authorities in the provincial capital, Guangzhou, had started mass testing or in its African community. So there was African community in the African neighborhood, so where there are a large number of migrant population living. So here they had started mass testing, and reports of discrimination and xenophobia followed. Means so this resulted in criticism coming from across the globe, and it was said by the migrant workers that they were being forcibly evicted by police from the accommodation, refused service at shops and restaurants, and were subjected to mass coronavirus testing and arbitrary quarantines. So now, because of this news, now China's province, southern Guangdong province, has launched anti-discrimination policies. So according to these policies, these are new anti-racism rules. Businesses and residential compounds have now been asked to implement non-discriminatory service, treat all Chinese and foreigners equally, and firmly oppose any racist, discriminatory speech or behavior. So this is the new rule which has come forth in this province. So that is it. Thank you.